the chair of today's meeting, Comrade T.K. Rangarajan, our senior leaders of the Parliament and the Congress Party, Mr. Sudarshan Nachiyappan, Mr. Thirunavakarasan, my leader of the DMK Party, my sister Kalimuri, the Reverend Father Francis Jayapathy, Professor Hajakani, Senior Director Raja Murugan, Sri Kandaswamy, Comrade Veerapandian of the CPI, and the various others sitting on the dais, and the distinguished audience that is there before me. I must confess why I took such a long time reading all the names was because I am completely overwhelmed and humbled at the thoughts that were said about me by the senior leaders of other parties and the bishop and the other leaders who have certain religious affiliations, because I am both honored, very touched and very humbled by all that they have said. But I'd only like to assure them that I have always been and I will always remain the foot soldier of the Indian people in the struggle to try and seek to convert our political independence into economic independence of our people that is possible only under socialism. But in order to do that, I have to safeguard my political independence today, and that political independence safeguarding, we will be a foot soldier in that struggle, whether inside Parliament or I'm outside. I can only assure them I'll be their fellow protester, fellow struggler, protecting this Indian constitution, because without that, India as we know of today cannot exist. So that is my assurance to all of them. I entered the Parliament and I've left the Parliament. In these 12 years, there have been a very interesting period, and it's been a learning process for me, and I'm very grateful for all my colleagues, some of whom have been here and spoke very kindly about me, for helping me in this learning process. The first four years was supporting the government, an outside support to the current government at the center, led by Dr. Manmohan Singh. Then came the Indo-US nuclear deal, the left had withdrawn support, and then after that, for the next 5 years, it was the role of both opposing the anti-people policies of the government and cautioning the government that if you continue to move this way, then you will only pave the way for the communal forces to come into office, and that is exactly what happened in 2014. The next 2 years was 2 years of complete opposition to this government in the defense of our motherland, in the defense of our constitution, in the defense of our country's secular democratic foundations. So we had a wide range of experience. But what we are seeing, wide range of experience for which I am grateful, but this experience has also taught us that today it is not only the role that the MPs play in the Parliament, but it is the role that each one of us, you and I, will have to play amongst the people of our country, because never have we faced the dangers that we are facing today for every aspect of constitutional rule and for the unity and integrity of India, and that unity of the people that is required, that will be my prime responsibility after leaving the Parliament, for which my whole life has already been dedicated, will continue to be. So therefore I assure Kanimuri, Thirunavakarasu and Sudarshan Nachiyappan, apart from Government T.K. Rangarajan, we all used to stay or sit very close to each other. Kanimuri used to be behind me, T.K. Rangarajan would be behind her, Mr. Thirunavakarasu would be the same front row as me, but a little distance, and the distance was only natural because he was closer to somebody else than what we were. So we were all day close together, but I only would like to assure them that I'm always there with you in the struggles. I'll be in the streets, and you please articulate our voice in the Parliament. Yes, I thought I knew some Tamil, but my pronunciation in Tamil was not correct, I'm told. So, Mr. Demonetisation. I believe I didn't pronounce your name properly. I'm sorry. No apologize. But today, why I'm talking of saying that we all have to be together is just look at the challenges. I mean, today there are four types of attacks on the country and the constitution, country, constitution and the people that are being mounted. You have these economic policies that have virtually ruined our economy, and there is no way that this Modi government knows of how to revive that economy and provide some relief to the people. Today, now, the finance secretary, while our meeting has begun, I got a message that the finance secretary, who was the author of this GST, and he oversaw that the GST, has given a message, it was speaking somewhere, and then he has said the GST has to be completely overhauled. This is coming from the secretary of finance, who is the key person responsible for implementation of the GST. In the condition of the economy is such, there was a cartoon in the North Indian papers. I don't want to, since a lot of time is over, I don't want to elaborate too much. There's a cartoon which explains everything. There's a cartoon in which Mr. Amit Shah is telling Mr. Modi that, Prime Minister, wherever I go to a public meeting, people are throwing shoes at me. So Modi replies to Mr. Amit Shah, he said, you direct that the GST on shoes should be increased to 28%. That is the only answer that they had. They are completely at a loss. Now that is the state in which they have ruined this economy. Why they have ruined, all of us know, we have our analysis, that they have ruined it in order to favor certain companies in our country. And when they talk that they have zero tolerance to corruption, you have the BJP's president's son now involved in the serious allegations that are not being investigated. You had the Sahara Diaries, you had the Panama Papers, you had the Lalit Modi case, you had the Vyapam case, you had the land scam case in Bihar. All these cases, the BJP leaders involved, not one investigation has begun. But on the opposition leaders, whether there is a case or not there, whether there is allegation or no allegation, they will be targeting them and campaign saying zero tolerance to corruption. The worst corruption that has taken place has been through the demonetization. This has been the biggest diabolical method of money laundering that has been undertaken in independent India. Today, all the money that is demonetized has come back. The Prime Minister says that cash in the to GDP ratio has declined, which is good. Today morning, the data has come out that the cash to GDP ratio is now 90%. 90% of the cash is back in your transactions. So they have no idea of what they are doing, but what they have done is converted all black money into white. They have legalized all your illicit money, your counterfeit money. They have neither been able to reduce terrorist attacks, in fact they have doubled. And the rate of corruption from a 1,000 rupee note has now become 2,000 rupee note. That corruption has actually doubled. So the net result has been what? The net result is exactly like the case of the BJP president's son, that money has been laundered. Money has been laundered by this process of demonetization, and this money laundering, the biggest beneficiary is the government, and this truth will come out one day. So this is the manner in which economy has been ruined for certain benefits, for certain people, the big corporates who are gaining. The ratio of 1% of Indians holding the percentage of GDP was 49% when Dr. Manmohan Singh left office. It has now crossed 60% in 3 years. In 3 years, more than 12% of the GDP has been added to the wealth of 1% of Indians. That means the other 99% of Indians, their share of the GDP has fallen correspondingly and drastically. This is the two Indias Mr. Modi is creating. Is this what we have all stood for? Equality. social and economic that our constitutional preamble talks for. This needs to be changed, and that is our appeal to every patriot in our country, that we must join in the struggle to change this situation and protect our country and the welfare of our people. On the other hand, the people's protests against these conditions are growing. They're growing in a big way. Our peasants who have been committing distress suicides are revolted in many states. The big peasant agitation that is forcing this government to give some concessions. And this discontent is there in every single section of our people of our country. And how to divert this discontent, away from becoming political against Mr. Modi and his government. And that they are doing by cementing the communal divide and sharpening communal polarization through their campaigns. Today, suddenly, Taj Mahal has become an issue of controversy. They say this is not part of India's culture. The UP Chief Minister talks of building a temple in Ayodhya irrespective of what the Supreme Court will say or do. They brought back onto the agenda all the issues that create communal tension and communal polarization. In the name of Gaurakshaks, Dalits and Muslims are being targeted, and those who have murdered in the name of Gaurakshaks, the murderers are being today rewarded by jobs being given to them in public sector, in the public sector factories. Instead of punishing them, this is what the government is doing, encouraging that. You have these moral policing squads going around telling our youngsters what they should wear, what they should eat, whom they should befriend. That is the takeover of the personal life of the people of our country, and that is being done by sharpening communal polarization. The entire foundation of our country's syncretic cultural tradition, the evolution of India as a confluence, of various traditions, various beliefs, various religions, various languages, which is what created this magnificent country, that is being threatened. And that's being threatened like never before. That is why what is emerging is an ideology. It's an ideology that India is only a Hindu Rashtra. India is not a confluence of various civilizational traits. And this is something that is completely inimical to our entire understanding in the Constitution or our own experience. The attempt to impose Hindi now once again, the resurrection of the slogan Hindu, Hindi, Hindustan, and that effort again to try and bring it back into Tamil Nadu. We have to now today retell our people and to confront this communal monster by understanding what do we mean by India, that is Bharat. That is the first clause of our constitution. India, that is Bharat, is a union of states. What is this Bharat? Bharat is Bharat, three syllables. What is Bha? We would, and I hope that everybody will interpret. Bha is Bhavam. What is our character? What is our expression? What is our opinion? Ra is Ragam. What is the Raga? That Raga is the confluence of seven different notes. Saregama Padani. Unless all these different notes come together, you can't have a Raga. And all these notes, some of them in their half, some of them in their higher octave, some of them in their lower octave, you can go through in the theory of music with so many permutation combinations, but it can only happen that a harmonious raga can only emerge when all these notes are, their confluence exists. And what is ta? Ta is talam. There is no harmony song without a rhythm, without a beat, without a talam. What is Bharata? Bhavam, ragam, talam. If Bhavam, Ragam, Talam are disrupted like the BJP RSS do, then this country doesn't exist. And that is what we need to protect, and that is where all of us have to come together. Raga Vanna Nasavas is seven notes. And seven notes to mingle, but na apko daham ho, unda chila the point. So finally, the point of emergency is the way in which the constitutional order is being destroyed. You see the Prime Minister today announcing a slew of projects when the elections to Gujarat should have been declared. Today, it has already appeared this morning in one of the wire portals that the Chief Election Commissioner is occupying an official accommodation in Gujarat when he was an officer of Gujarat 3 years ago. He is not vacated there and he is now the Chief Election Commissioner. And he has applied to the Gujarat government saying, please extend my hold over that house. If that is the case, it is a very serious matter. I don't know if it is right or wrong. But it has to be clarified, the Chief Election Commissioner is a constitutional authority beyond any executive obligation. Now, if this case is true, then the degree of manipulation of our constitutional scheme of things is amazing that is happening. Now, my colleagues, Mr. Nagendra Krishnan, Mr. Nachiappan and Karimudi, and TKR, will have to continue to battle how the Rajya Sabha is being bypassed, how educational institutions are being converted into Hindutva laboratories, how research bodies and cultural institutions are being occupied. This is a serious assault on a constitutional law. All this needs to be fought. If all this has to be fought, it is Indian patriotism, not Hindutva nationalism, that has to be our slogan. So Indian patriotism and all patriotic forces will have to come together. And that is a struggle that we'll have to lead amongst the people of our country. And I only hope that we'll be able to strengthen these struggles in the future, because otherwise there is no hope for maintaining and improving the India that we know and making a better India. So while inviting all of you and appealing to all of you, come forward, let us save our India today to change India for the better. I once again thank the Honourable my erstwhile colleagues in the Parliament, the Honourable leaders in the dais for saying very kind words about me, and also for expressing their solidarity, and we wish the solidarity will continue. All Indian patriots will come together to safeguard India today so that we can create a better India tomorrow. With these words, I take leave of you. Thank you.